Simon & Schuster Audio presents Run Me to Earth, a novel by Paul Yoon. Read by Ramón de Ocampo.
Author's note. In the 1960s, during the war in Vietnam, Laos was engaged in its own conflict between the communist Pathet Lao and the Royal Lao government. In an attempt to suppress the spread of communism across Southeast Asia, the United States, using the Central Intelligence Agency, provided extensive support to the RLG. The CIA's paramilitary operation included training ethnic groups, in particular the Hmong, to fight alongside the government, and then, later, carrying out aerial bombing missions over the country. These bombing missions would last 9 years, from 1964 to 1973, and would end up totaling more than 580,000. This is the equivalent of one bombardment every 8 minutes, 24 hours a day, for 9 years. Over 2 million tons of ordnance were dropped on Laos, more than was dropped on both Germany and Japan during the Second World War. 30% of these cluster bombs, or bombies, failed to explode on impact. While Run Me to Earth focuses on this time period and these events, its story, and the characters and the situations depicted, is an act of imagination. P.Y. I have worn the fur of a wolf, and the shepherd's dogs have run me to earth. W.S. Merwin. Alisak, 1969. At the farmhouse, the three friends asked each other where they went to at nights. They had finished most of their duties for the day and were sitting down on the floor together in the corner of the long room that had, 2 decades ago, held dances and lavish parties, but had now been converted into a ward.
A ship, Prany said. I go to a very large ship.
Someplace where there is a working fireplace?
Prany's younger sister Noi said, leaning back against the wall.
A very large fireplace.
Noi had been disappointed to learn that all the fireplaces in this house had been found sealed up when the doctors first arrived. Above them, there was a gap in the ceiling where they could see 2 stars in the passing clouds. In front of them, at the end of the rows of cots, a woman tried to turn in her sleep, forgetting that her legs and her torso had been eaten alive when she stepped on an unexploded cluster bomb 3 days ago. Then the woman remembered what happened, but she avoided looking down, watching instead the moonlight coming in through the tall windows that lined the far wall. They kept the curtains open because those who couldn't sleep wanted to look outside at what was left of the distant valley. It was called the Plain of Jars because of the strange stones scattered across this part of the country, as though a mountain had fallen from the sky and shattered. As far back as they could recall, Alisak, Prany, and Noi had heard so many stories of the megalithic stone jars, they weren't sure which one was true. Whether they were intended to collect rainwater for travelers, whether they were used to make wine for warriors who would return from great battles. It was also said that the jars once belonged to giants who roamed these hills. And others thought the jars had nothing to do with the earth at all, and that in some future time, someone or something would come back for them. When the first bombs dropped, Alisak, who had been working on a farm that morning, was so stunned by the sound he was unable to move, even as the horizon dispersed into a wall of smoke. His first thought, they've come for the jars. These days he laughed at that old life. From the gap in the ceiling came the faraway engines of airplanes, and he waited for the detonations of the cluster bombs somewhere west or north of them. There had been so many bombings. It was getting more frequent. He lost count of how many a day. He almost didn't notice the sound anymore. A bird call, which he never heard anymore, would be stranger. The sky flashed and flashed. Eventually, Alisak knew, maybe next week or in a month, the bombers would come back around toward the house. Not for them, but again for the roads and the valleys. Yesterday, Prany packed bags for them, hidden now under a loose floorboard in a bedroom upstairs. He managed to stash one of the house pistols, too.
Alisak, Prany said, leaning across, clutching a pillow and poking him. You didn't answer.
Alisak forgot they were playing the game. He was wearing a blister on his palm from the handlebars of the motorcycle he had been riding all day. The blister had burst, and the flap of skin had turned almost as pale as the moonlight catching their boots.
The desert, Alisak said. I go to the desert.
Noi tipped her head back. She thought this was hilarious. She stayed that way, laughing quietly, her mouth open like a fledgling bird that was about to catch something from above.
In the next life, she said, our friend will be a Bedouin.
What's a Bedouin? Prany said.
Noi hit her brother on the head, and then the two curled themselves around the frayed, embroidered pillows they had found upstairs on a bench beside an out-of-tune piano. A sheet of Bach was still on the piano stand, the pages yellowed, but the bars and the notes were clear and dark. The siblings tried to sleep, their limbs making scratching noises on the marble floor as they settled. If it rained, they would have to move. But through the course of the year, they had become better at predicting the weather, and tonight, they bet it wouldn't. The gap was perhaps the circumference of a jar in the valley. They liked looking up at it. If the sky was small enough, there was less of a chance of an airplane crossing over it. If the sky was small enough, it was just the sky. Alisak stayed up, watching Noi, then watching the beds. First shift. If something happened, if someone tried to rip the IV from their arms and leave, or if someone screamed because the morphine was exiting out of their bodies, he would have to run down the hall past the six mirrors on each wall that caught his movements until he found a doctor or a nurse. Most of them were in the kitchen, sleeping in whatever privacy they could imagine as they lay on a counter or on the floor, in a closet or against the angle of cupboards, having drunk enough whiskey to knock themselves out. Some of the staff had even begun to take the morphine themselves, the ends of a suturing thread from an operation still wrapped around their fingertips like a good luck charm. And sometimes, resting on their open palm as though they were perpetually ready for surgery, there would be a scalpel. For this, for keeping watch, and for keeping the ward clean, for assisting these people who were trying to save as many civilians as possible in a war that had been going on in various forms for almost all their lives, and for riding the motorcycles, they were paid more American dollars in a day than they could earn in 6 months on the streets of Funsavin. They had even learned some English and French this year from the Vientiane doctor they called Vang. He was perhaps in his 30s, if that, wore glasses he kept misplacing, and, as it turned out, was not only proficient in several languages, but played the piano. In the ward when his two friends were asleep, Alisak practiced saying some French phrases to himself, as the sky flashed with another detonation and the woman on the bed placed an arm across her eyes, her mouth slowly moving, as though she were practicing the language with him. He wondered, as he often did, about the Frenchman who once lived there. He, the Frenchman, was a captain from the Second World War, had retired here and gotten rich off the tobacco fields around the property that no longer existed. For Alisak, he was all rumor, a drunk and a womanizer who spent his days in a long silk bathrobe waiting for his next party to begin. A man who stayed in this country for much longer than most of the French, and whose allegiances could be bought. Who, early in the war, let North Vietnamese soldiers use his fields as a route on their way to the southern parts of Vietnam. How much of this was true? Alisak, entering a room, would sometimes pause, wondering what his days and roots were like within this house that was the size of a small village. Noi had in fact met him once, Alisak only at a glance, long before they knew who he was. He pulled up to them on the side of the road one day and had asked if he could hire Noi to help in the kitchen at one of his parties. So she had gone with him, though she refused to speak much about that evening. She only shared with Alisak the bits of conversations she had overheard from the partygoers. Did you ever notice the river is changing temperature? And that the man was very strange. That, and her regret at not eating more of the food she had been hired to carry on silver trays. Noi had been 12. In the rare times she mentioned him at all, she called him the tobacco captain. So Alisak had begun to think of him that way. Strike a match. Captain of not much, just ash. This man who had lived alone in this house he had built for himself, with all its windows that revealed all the distances. A house that even now as a skeleton seemed to Alisak as grand and mysterious as a temple. In her sleep, Noi slid across, thinking Alisak's lap was a pillow. She was dreaming. He could sense the shudder of it, as if she were leaping. She twisted up slightly, and he stared at the rise of her hip, that angular bone. Began to reach for it, but changed his mind, suddenly self-conscious of the fact that he hadn't bathed in a week. He looked away. Her hand fluttered. And then he reached down and turned the old ring around her thumb that she had found somewhere and never took off, because she often did this herself, when she was troubled, or when her mind was far. And as her body calmed, and she rolled back to her pillow, he also wondered, as he often did, if anything had happened to her at the party. And if something did, what that was. He tried to remember the car, and that man inside, calling them over. And that he himself had stood there doing nothing, staring at the man's money.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.